Sunday and Easter happens to be Good Shepherd Sunday. So we're going to hear that familiar psalm, Psalm 23, and we're going to hear Jesus talk about being our shepherd. And of course, it's also Mother's Day, and so we give thanks for the many, many maternal figures in our lives. I invite you to join me in the bulletin for our Thanksgiving for baptism. Again, we shout, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
In the waters of baptism, we have passed over from death to life with Jesus Christ, and we are a new creation. For this saving mystery and for this water, let us bless God, who was, who is, and who is to come. We thank you, God, for your river of life, flowing freely from your throne, through the earth, through the city, through every living thing. You rescued Noah and his family from the flood. You opened wide the sea for the Israelites. Now in these waters, you flood us with mercy, and our sin is drowned forever. You open the gate of righteousness, and we pass safely through. In Jesus Christ, you calm the troubled waters. You nourish us and enclose us in safety. You call us forth and send us out. In lush and barren places, you are with us. You have become our salvation. Now breathe upon this water and awaken your church once more. Claim us again as your beloved and holy people. Quench our thirst, cleanse our hearts, wipe away every tear. To you, our beginning and our end, our shepherd and lamb, be honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving, now and forever.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able for our gathering song.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God of peace, you brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep. By the blood of your eternal covenant, make us complete in everything good, that we may do your will and work among us all that is well-pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
First reading is from Acts. Now in Joppa there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples who heard that Peter was there sent two men to him with the request, Please come to us without delay. So Peter got up and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them aside, outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, Tabitha, get up. Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
This morning is the 23rd Psalm. We will read it responsibly. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters.
He restored my soul, O Lord, and guide me along the right pathways, and for your sake, name's sake.
The Lord walked through the valley of the shadow of death. I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
The second reading is from Revelation. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, Who are these dressed robed in white, and where have they come from? I said to him, Sir, you are the one that knows. Then he said to me, These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will guide them to springs of the water of life. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Grace, mercy, and peace from our loving God, Father, risen Son, and Holy Spirit. Maya Angelou once said that words mean more than what is set down on paper. It takes the human voice to infuse them with deeper meaning. The voice, as you know, is a powerful tool. It can bring comfort, can encourage and lift up. It can call out wrongdoing or injustice. And it can also push us to do better. It can convict us. And it can tear us and others down. I want you to think about someone in your life whose voice made a positive impact on your life. Maybe you lift up a maternal figure on this Mother's Day, or a friend, a teacher, coach. Take just a moment to share with a neighbor now, not only their words, but their voice, how that made an impact on your life. Go ahead and do that. Dive into our lesson this morning. It is important to note that while we are still in the season of Easter, we are no longer reading about the risen Jesus. So for the next few weeks, we will meet Jesus at different, seemingly random points in his earthly ministry. Today, John 10, where Jesus claims to be our good shepherd. So we meet Jesus in the temple for the festival of dedication, or as you and I would call it, Hanukkah. And as he is there, a community of voices cry out, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us." Now, we do not know the intent of their voices. Perhaps they are indeed curious, desperately hoping that their Messiah has finally come. Some suggest, though, that it would be a more accurate translation to say, how long will you annoy or vex us? It seems that maybe both are true here. After all, Jesus has received mixed reviews from the crowds that follow him, no matter what he does. An example, remember he heals the man on the Sabbath, and some are amazed while others are furious that he would dare work. It's likely that the crowd we meet today has a similarly mixed attitude toward Jesus. And it is from that place that they lift their voices. The voice that stands out most in this story, though, is Jesus's. If the crowd wanted a clean and clear answer from him, well, they didn't get it. Jesus doesn't answer with a simple yes or no, as we would like, but instead directs them to his actions, invites them to look at his character. He then goes on to tell them that they do not understand because, well, they are not one of his sheep. The voice of Jesus here almost leaves us scratching our heads. Are these people not worthy of the flock? Why not? How can it change that? In my short years as a pastor, I have met many people who have experienced a similar struggle with belonging and worth. In fact, I would argue that this is a real experience that we all share. The hearing of voices that diminish our value and our welcome. There are so many voices like this, even just within Christianity. Many of those voices demanding something of us, praying a certain prayer, subscribing to a particular theology or set of beliefs, becoming members in order to participate in the sacraments, hard work to earn our way to heaven, and the list goes on. There are so many voices talking at us, so many voices calling us into questioning our worth, our place in this story. And these are only the voices within the Christian community. Add what we hear from our friends or family members, and probably the toughest one, how rough we can be on ourselves, questioning our own value, our own place in this flock. We hear all these voices and we are left, to quote the psalmist, in the valley of the shadow of death. And so we ask, are we worthy to be sheep? Have we done enough to be able to follow the shepherd? Friends, we continue to listen to this response from Jesus. We seek desperately to hear words of comfort, words of belonging. And then they come. The voice of the Good Shepherd rings out, and it is music to our ears. My sheep hear my voice, Jesus says. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. It becomes clear that the shepherd is the one who seeks out the sheep. That the shepherd calls out, that the shepherd knows the sheep, that he gives them life and protection. The sheep don't ask, pray, beg, or work to earn their place. Here we hear that God is the one who initiates this relationship. It is God who seeks out the sheep, not the other way. Dear ones, we gather yet again to shout Alleluia this Easter season. And we are met with a familiar voice that we are still yet so desperate to hear. A voice that speaks life, hope, and belonging into our lives. Jesus, our Good Shepherd, meets us with words of comfort and relief. God does not require us to have it all right. God does not require us to leave our doubt at the door. We do not have to say a certain thing or work simple. We are God's sheep. Period. Jesus insists that this is true. Here, in his saving act on the cross, and as he ascends to prepare a place for us all. So, fellow sheep, in a world with so many loud voices, let us give thanks for the voice that has given us life. The voices that we shared with our neighbors just moments ago, and even more so, the voice of our Good Shepherd. Let us listen to this voice that speaks value, belonging, life, and love into our lives. And then let us open ourselves to the direction in which our shepherd is leading us. And let us too rest in the promise that nothing, absolutely nothing, can snatch us from Jesus' love and care. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Friends, the Good Shepherd has claimed us, each and every one of us. And he is calling our names. And for that, we rejoice and celebrate. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
And all God's people say.
Begotten of the Father. is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated for the prayer.
Friend, in our reading today, see free from captivity, set free from captivity to sin and death. We praise you, God, for resurrection of the church, people in need, and all creation. Gentle Shepherd, enable your church to respond to the voice of Jesus. Give us unfailing trust and afraid to join Jesus' work of renewing all things. God, in your glory, feed your people at the table of creation. Prepare a safe place for those whose environments are dangerous or unhealthy, especially those making difficult journeys and those whose voices and choices are limited. Prosper your creation and all that let all my flourish. God, in your mercy, warm the hearts of all who celebrate and all who mourn on Mother's Day. Accompany those yearning to be mothers. Help us to heal from a broken family relationship and open us to receive your nurturing love from all who serve mothering roles in our lives. God, in your mercy, seek out those who weep while they reach healing or consolation, especially those who remain now either loud or silent. Set people in their hands who can provide the care they need and wipe away the tears from their eyes. God, in your mercy, inspire the words of prophets and saints who employed initiative, imagery to stretch out understanding. Send Christ to instruct us with motherly care. God, in your mercy, enfold us in the great multitude of saints from every nation, from every tribe, people, and language. Wash us in your saving grace this day, every day. Guide us to your waters of life. God, in your mercy, in your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-saving Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Friends, in our readings today, we see God as shepherd, guides us through the greatest of days, and those days we find ourselves in the valley of death and despair. We do not have to look far to find these shadow-filled valleys today. There are people who suffer or are hungry, ice caps that are melting, and churches that seem to be fading away. Until the day these shadowed valleys shine bright, giving to bring about a better world truly does matter. So we collect our tithes and offerings now to help grow green pastures here and far beyond. Hopeful hearts, let us pray. thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You nourish the lands with water. You molded us in your image, and with mercy higher than the mountains and grace deeper than the seas, you blessed the Israelites and cherished them as your own. That also we, estranged and dying, might be adopted to live in your spirit. You called to us through the life and death of Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. Gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Together as the body of Christ, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your Son, the firstborn of your new creation. We remember his life lived for others, and his death and resurrection, which renews the face of the earth. We await his return, when with the world made perfect through your wisdom, all our sins and sorrows will be no more.
Amen. Amen. Amen, Lord Jesus.
Holy God, holy and merciful one, holy and compassionate, send upon us in this meal your Holy Spirit, whose breath revives us for life, whose fire rouses us to love. Enfold in your arms all who share this holy food. Nurture in us the fruits of the Spirit, that we may be a living tree, sharing your bounty with all the world.
Amen. Come, Holy Spirit.
Holy and benevolent God, receive our praise and petitions as Jesus received the cry of the needy, and fill us with your blessing. Until needy no longer and bound to you in love, we feast forever in the triumph of the Lamb, through whom all glory and honor is yours, O God, O living one, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but
but I'll forward it. But can you grab the microphone on the back? Thanks. All right. First, you may have noticed on the signs as you walked in that we have a new to Pilgrim lunch coming up next Sunday at 12:30. And so if you're kind of new to the community and would like to learn more, or if you're interested in membership, do come enjoy some pizza and conversation with me. Bring your questions. It'll be a wonderful time. And we will keep that to 1 hour to honor all of your time and thanks. If you have a student within or between fourth and sixth grades, you've likely received an email or should have received an email from me this week regarding First Communion class. It's something that kind of got, you know, set aside during COVID, but now we're back and we're able to do that, and so we're going to catch up. And so I sent an email out to those families. If you did not get an email, please see me after worship so I can get that communicated with you. And then a final date will be set tomorrow. Excited. Our Is That Biblical Bible study continues Wednesday at 10 a.m. We had fun conversation this last week. We even played a fun little game, and so we invite you to come, and we'll ponder some wonderful questions for the next several weeks here. Our Little League concession stand volunteering begins this week, and so if you're signed up, or you're not sure if you're signed up, check it out. Tomorrow is the day that we begin. And so that looks like 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock volunteering on those days. If you haven't signed up yet, you still can do that in the narthex at the information desk. It is a lot of fun, more fun than you would imagine, so check that out. And those confirmation kits are still making their way forward, I think. Come on up.
Hosting a bake sale in Narthex to help support Lutheran Bone Relief. All funds will be raised and designated towards their efforts in Ukraine.
Check it out, there are plenty of treats to go around.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let us go into the work of our Lord.